I get very self-conscious when I'm talking to a mic. Kind of brings out the inner singer that I have. But yeah, I'm not going to bore you with that. The idea is that at the end of the presentation, at the end of what we have today, at the end of 2 hours, we will be sending out, or we will be releasing all the content that we have, including the virtual machines, the Gitbook, the script, the code, all of that. We're going to make it public. And you folks can take it down and try it out in your own personal systems. Because some of these require internet connectivity. Some of them require some amount of processing. And some of the examples we're going to cover. And the way the, so we're going to call it like a talk slash workshop now. The way this is structured, some of it you folks can practice on your systems. Right? If you have internet access, you can, there are a couple of sites we're going to show you which allow you to pull information and other things as part of OSINT. Right? You can definitely try that as and when you see, if you have access to internet here, you could go ahead and try that out. Okay. Now, the primary focus, the primary intent of the workshop is to ensure that everybody in the room is familiar with OSINT, right? That's the whole idea. You all here, you have some basic amount of knowledge and coverage of the idea of OSINT, right? What we're going to try and show in the next hour and a half, 2 hours, is how do you take the amount of data that is out there in terms of OSINT, and specifically when you're focusing on targets that you want to, you know, you're trying to attack and you're building your attack chain, your attack toolkit. How do you take that data and you visualize it, right? And the visualization has multiple, you know, multiple pros. The idea of visualization enables you to see what is available at the moment. You can compare it with something else that you're trying to figure out, right? A simple example would be subdomains, for example, right? How many of you have done bug bounty here in the room before? Bug bounty hunters? Okay, anybody who's from a penetration testing background? Right. So the idea is that when you're trying to attack, right, when you're trying to attack a target, you would want to find out as much information about the target as possible. Right. The visual cue that I like to paint for attendees normally is the idea of you trying to get into a house. Okay. Now, before you enter the house, you don't normally try and break into the house directly. You would scout around the house, you try to figure out when the occupants of the house are available, not available, when they're out, how many windows are there, are there fences around, do they have dogs, are their windows unlocked. All of this information, right, analogous to what we do in a penetration testing exercise. We will be trying to enhance the amount of data that we have with open source information that we gather. Right? The idea of today's workshop is going to align with that, and we are going to cover 3 scenarios where this is useful, right? And the scenarios will be in a way where you would be able to use data that is available to you, that you've discovered online. And Madhu is going to cover most of the automation and the visualization bit, right? And how do you visualize this so that it is presentable to somebody with either within your team or to your management if you're going to go coming at it from a defense point of view, right? Like go back to your senior management folk and show them that, hey, this is what is visible. You like fancy graphs? Here you go. These are pie charts that you can maybe talk to your other board of directors and see what shit is open on the internet. Right? So that's what you're going to do. So essentially, we're going to cover 3 scenarios today. Okay? The first scenario is what we would like to the way I would like to put it, the first scenario allows us to detect in near real time. The first scenario allows us to detect in near real time if there are SSL certificates for your subdomains being released. Right? We have something called as a certificate transparency log. How many of you are familiar with certificate transparency logs? All right. We'll talk about that briefly. Right, and it's really interesting because we're going to show you a couple of demos in the form of web applications on the internet, web services on the internet, that you can go back and if you have access to the internet, try it out on your organization domains. Right, and it's completely passive, and then you will be surprised at the amount of information that it leaks. Okay, we're going to use in the first scenario a certificate transparency logs to figure out if any certificates have been issued for subdomains. Okay. That you're trying to target for a particular company. The second scenario uses a forward DNS set. It's an open data set by Rapid7. We're going to use that to try and visualize what is the infrastructure for a particular target organization that you're going to be attacking, right? All the DNS information that the organization has available in the form of visual cues, okay? And the third scenario is going to be if you can detect, or rather in a way, how would you go about detecting and visualizing if somebody's created rogue domain names that look similar and, you know, appear similar verbally or contextually in enunciation as well to your organization. Like you've seen those phishing campaigns, right? Phishing campaigns and scammers would want to be able to visualize the target domain as nearly as the original domain. And it kind of adds to the whole value of the scamming operation. You would want to have, suppose somebody was trying to scam Gmail, right? And Gmail users. If you could register a domain with GM, with two A's and IL, that would be a far more, right, viable opportunity for scammers to get hook into the people who they're trying to fish. So that's the third scenario. We're going to again visualize that data. Again, as I said at the beginning, we are going to give away all the entire documentation along with a virtual machine that we're going to release, right, at the end of this. And we're going to release it on GitHub, and we're going to tweet about it using Recon Village or even our AppSeco account, right? So just follow us whenever the data is available. You should be able to clone that. Wait. Oh yeah, I've been asked to put a add the disclaimer bit that please, mostly reconnaissance is considered is almost always passive, right? The idea of recon is trying to be as passive as possible, but sometimes you do touch the remote target, right? There are test cases that you would run when finding information that you would sometimes touch the target. And I would recommend, I've seen this in the real world with the several years of pen testing experience that I have, and being part of the company AppSeco. I've worked at Citrix before and other companies before that. The idea is that ensure that you have permission. Your local country laws can easily screw you up. If somebody wants to get back to you, they will get back to you, right? So the code and the other things that we're going to release in as part of this class, they're not production ready, right? But you can go back, modify them and use them, use it for your test cases and see if they become viable to you. All right? Yeah, go to the ELSKit. I'll let Madhu introduce the primary visualization platform that we're going to use, the ELK stack. How many of you are familiar with Elasticsearch? ELK? Oh, cool. He's going to introduce that to you and then we can move on to...
This is the boss workshop.
Yeah. So before that, our primary trainer, our primary speaker for this class, Bharat, he ran into visa issues like most people who couldn't make it to DEF CON or Black Hat this year. So he says hi to everyone, right? So back from India. He's an active member of my team. I head the offensive security team at AppSeco. He's an active member of the team, and he's our primary go-to recon guy. Right, and his idea of obtaining information, and we've done tons of, I'll probably give you a couple examples during the talk where we've used very minuscule amount of information available to us to completely pawn an entire organization. Right, we have a couple of test cases like that, brilliant stories. Right, so I'm going to talk about them as well. But yeah, his core interest lies in infrasec, application security, and a lot of reconnaissance work that he does. And he's done a couple of talks as well. So he just wanted us to bring this up. This is Madhu, my colleague at AppSeco again. He's another part of, he's another member of my team, right? And I see that my name isn't there. So I'm just going to say hi. So Riaz here, right? So I'm going to be pitching in whenever the opportunity occurs. Over to you, Madhu.
Thank you. So as Riaz introduced, most of the stuff we will be trying to focus on Recon, and the primary the focus of the workshop will be mainly data sets. That is the one of the reason we choose kind of ELK stack. I think most of you are already familiar with ELK stack, as you said. So ELK is primarily allows three things as ELK, Elasticsearch, Logstash, Kibana. So each piece has individual plus and advantages and disadvantages. Suppose if your organization have really good data sets, like which they have normalized and put it in JSON, then you don't want it to use Logstash. Right, Logstash is kind of normalizing and make sure everything data which you are getting and send it to a Elasticsearch or S3 buckets or whichever the data source output you wanted to send. And coming to Elasticsearch, Elasticsearch is kind of a large NoSQL kind of data store where you kind of store all the data which is coming from the logstash or like from other data sources, which will store an index using Elasticsearch. And the final, the output, whatever we wanted to showcase is we will be using Kibana. So Kibana is kind of front-end using, I think, written in AngularJS, which is fancy graphs and the visualization to showcase the data. This will make query to Elasticsearch and get the data to represent in a visual format.
Okay.
And just to give again one more time, so we will be going through multiple demonstrations rather than giving hands-on, because we couldn't able to make sure give virtualization software now and troubleshoot. But we will be releasing this VM, whatever we are trying to showcase now, and you can go back and try using the steps. You can follow or like tweet to us like if you have any questions. Yeah. So I'll just quickly highly showcase like how it looks like in the configuration, because this is one of the primary ingredient to set up entire the visualization platform. So if you see in terms of especially logstash part, so it has three types of formats. One is input, filter, and output. So input is kind of a plugins where it supports, I think, nearly 50 plus amount of plugins. It can be taken data from your sysmon servers, like system monitoring, as well as any S3 buckets or directly file inputs. So in the scenarios which we are going to cover for the three, we'll be taking currently as a file output, but it can be taken from anywhere else, right? And the similarly, filter is one of the key piece why people try to use logstash. For example, if you have a data set which contains IP addresses, right, which you wanted to enrich data using, suppose longitude, latitude, which country, where is the region. So filters kind of allows you to do that. It uses a GeoIP database like by MaxMine. What it does is you say that this is the field I wanted to enrich. It will go ahead and enrich that data and give you more granular results. And the output is kind of decision maker, whether you wanted to send it to Elasticsearch if you prefer, or your team has really good amount of big data stuff, you can go ahead and send it to Apache Spark or like Hadoop clusters. And it supports, I think, nearly 60 plus plugins output, so that you can go ahead and take actions as well here as well, right? And this is again one of the piece which is like hanging around, especially if ELK stack around. So Beats is kind of a data shippers. Like if you are familiar with network security, like people use it to send the network switches data like logs to a centralized system monitoring server, right? So Beats is kind of a Golang binary which sits in wherever you wanted to send the data from sources and send it to a Elasticsearch or logstash, right? And it's very lightweight. The good part about this thing, they kind of integrated with Kafka. Like if you don't want to lose not even a single log, it will go in and send it to a Kafka streaming, so you can push and pull like methodology stuff. And the people, if you are most interested in like a packet level understanding, like especially in your organizations, they have released a packet beat as well. Like it kind of look at DNS queries and network monitoring as well, each packet level. Cool. And we are just gonna skip this section, like not going very deep into ELK stack. If you wanted to go back and refer like more interested in area, so we kind of made a quick git book to deep dive into ELK stack. And again, it's in the reference section. I think my internet is super slow. So I'll just update this anyway whenever we update. The URL is here at the end, appseco.com/book/ELK workshop. So if you wanted to deep dive and use that stuff. So the second phase is alerting. While we are storing huge amount of data sets, the key piece is we can't keep looking at the data, because it's a human job to make mistakes. Like you may not miss like a look at everything, you may miss out something. So alerting is kind of enables, like rather than keep looking at whatever you look interesting, you can go ahead and send it to some other place based on certain alert queries. How many of you use Slack here? Who doesn't, right? So Slack is kind of the alerting we will be using here is ElastAlert. Again, it's as title said, we will be using most of the open source stuff. ElastAlert is an open source project by ELP, so where it completely work with ELK stack to query the data using REST API and send back the data based on the queries which you made to the ELK stack alerting system, right? And the very important features it support. At the end, you can see fine the text. Cool. A little bigger.
Yeah, that's it. I think I felt the same.
Little better.
Okay.
So, if you see this, this is a very simple rule. It looks like it is. We will be using in the coming section in the scenario. What it does is it will keep looking for the locks, and if it matches any of your organization certificate, which is generated a TLS certificate using any Let's Encrypt or like your proprietary certificate authorities, it will go ahead and send an alert, right? It's kind of keep monitoring for our new certificate updates and to track of inventory of certificates as well. So this is a simple filter. What we are doing is we are looking for the index to receive the logs, and if it matches in number of events based on the alert, it'll go ahead and look for the query, which we will be showing in coming section, and it will send a Slack alert, right? Similarly, it can be many other, but it's kind of more integrated with Elasticsearch, so we have chosen. And if you have like a really good fancy other stuff, it is feel free to use because the open source we have chosen this. People might be using Splunk, ArcSight, and other ways. They can go and use as well. Same things. And it has different types of rule set supports. Like if you wanted to configure based on the rule sets and alert types, so it can send it to email, SNS, Jira tickets to raise it to security team and talk to them, developers. So I'll go ahead and move into hands-on section. If you have any questions or if you see anything like missing or like some stuff, please go ahead and ask right away. Font, fine. Back, looks fine. Cool. So we have set it up a ELK stack already in this virtual machine, pre-configured using Ansible playbook, which we will be again use giving that as well, like if you wanted to go back and set it up. So I'll quickly show you the configuration. So this is a Elasticsearch configuration. So what we are trying to say here is we have created a new cluster saying that Elastic Stack, and we created a one node because for the workshop we just using one machine. If you are storing like, sorry. Oh, okay. Hey, black is much fun. It's black on the background. I'll just zoom in. So the cluster name, if you wanted to run huge data sets, it may be better to use clustering mode and with different nodes. And this is like a very basic configuration. And the one thing we are trying to put is, most of you might find in Shodan searches, if you use Shodan, like Elasticsearch doesn't have by default authentication. If you put 0.0.0 here, anyone can access your cluster out there. Basically your data is out in the internet. So we kind of harden that part. And by default it listens on 9200 port, and that's it. So this is very high level basic configuration to work with Elastic Stack, and you can just make curl request to localhost 9200. You can see that the cluster is up and running, and we can able to send and receive the data from the cluster API using that 9200 port, right? And once we have set up the cluster, so we have a place and data store to receive or send it back. So now we have to get the data, right? So getting the data part, we will be using logstash. As I said, like I'll quickly show the logstash configuration as well, so that you will be able to get idea of how the logs are coming in place and how it will exchange. Any questions like till Elasticsearch part, because am I going too fast or like, because people will give me feedback saying that I go too fast. So if I'm like too fast, please let me know. I'll make it slow down and let it be clear. So in this phase, if you see, I'll just make it font. So this is an input configuration. So as I said, logstash has three phases. One is input configuration and output. And once you have understand these basic stuff, I think you can go ahead and not only the data which we are showcasing, you can explore any data, it's at the end like passing that data and making sure that getting some sense out of the data, right? Visualizations. So here what we are doing is we are listening on port 5044 for the log stash. So anyone can able to reach 5044 of this virtual machine can able to send data to the beats, the log stash. So if you wanted to use SSL certs like for this to make sure this is over TLS, you can able to configure that and it is over TLS. So once we receive, we kind of apply filters. So for this, we are using two different scenarios, the log sets. One is search stream, as Riaz mentioned. So which is kind of mostly data coming from the certificate transparency logs. We are currently picking up from crt.sh. I'll just quickly show you how the logs looks like. So whenever it matches saying that search stream in the tags, like we tag the data, whenever it is sending it to logstash, it will go ahead and perform these filters. Currently there is no filter because we kind of directly getting JSON. And if you have different kind of data sets, these filters allows us to parse that data. So you can go back and check the logstash plugin sub filter. So it has huge amount of data filterizations. So if you look at for the same thing like scan Cybo data, the filters, we will be using GeoIP filter because scan Cybo data has IP addresses coming or like domain names. So what we are trying to do is rather than going and passing directly IP addresses and domain names, we are resolving them and we are trying to capture their longitude, latitude, as well as the domain information as well. And again, sending it back to Elasticsearch so that we can able to make some data sense, right? And once everything is done, so we kind of sending everything currently to Elasticsearch, which is again currently running in localhost 9200. So once the data is receiving and perform the filterization, it will go and stays in the Elasticsearch. So if you see the index, index is automatically created based on every day. So you will create different indexes every day to search back. So that is about mostly cluster configuration. We'll just go back and look at the data sets so that we can able to see how it's going to be parsing into the ELK stack. So this is the one which we are talking about the previously. The crt.sh is the one which we are taking the logs, the certificate transparency logs. We will be making query using the Postgres. They have a Postgres interface. And if you wanted to run like huge amount of queries, they kind of block that. You can request a different credentials. They kind of give you like Postgres guest admin credentials. So you can have go and query and perform some research on top of like certificate transparency logs. Yeah. I think I'll just do a quick check. I'll switch off my monitor to make sure my internet is working.
Yeah, it's working.
So, yeah. So I'll just go ahead and make a simple query to showcase how the data looks like so that we will see how we can go ahead and parse the data.
If you can't see, please let me know. I try to make sure like I'm increasing the font always. So if I miss out, like please let me know.
So currently it supports different kind of queries. If you use their CLI, especially the Postgres, the interface, it's kind of you SQL-like interface to query the database. But in web, you kind of use like percentage to say that this is a wildcard and regular expression type.
So I'll go ahead and give one of the name like Defcon, okay. Like I wanted to give someone, anyone wanted to participate and give one of the domain. Buckcrowd.com. Okay. So percentage here is like a wildcard. So it's kind of gets all the data. And again, I think looks like my internet is super slow. Yeah. There you go.
So if you see in the identity field, so this log that whenever it creates a certificate and as well as the Buckcrowd has like a subdomain for this, like they have created a certificate called a.buckcrowd. And if you say that blog.buckcrowd.com, which is again generated by DigiCert. Like you can see the who is the certificate authority as well. So you can go ahead and use these kind of data to find subdomains as well, right? As a bounty hunter, they want like mainly look at like if you have given a domain, what are the subdomains so that they can find more issues in terms of possible attack surface, right? If you in terms of pen tester point of view, it will apply similarly. Like if you have given a target, it may not be the same way to go, right? You might find other ways to let it into the target. So this is one of the good place to look at because most of the people don't wanted to make their servers as applications run in a HTTP. So they kind of generate a TLS certificate. As per the regulations or standards, they have to be available the certification transparency logs. So if you don't want it to be here as a defense point of view, so you have to run your PKI, public key infrastructure, for yourself. Right. Yeah, so I'll be showing the output, the same output in a JSON format, how it looks like. So this is how it looks like, but I'll try to make it like looks simpler. I'll just so I kind of ran JQ. The JQ is like JSON parsing stuff tool. Yeah, if you see from one certificate, basically it starts from the data. And it has like the certificate link, the information about extensions, authority, and each and every information related to the certificate which is generated from the transparency log. So this is the log we wanted to pass it to the our ELK stack. So we have already pretty good JSON. So we can have directly use that to send it to Elasticsearch and Logstash. So if you have seen like some type of other data sets, like not for this scenario, maybe you can have used some other filters to make it properly parsed into Logstash. So you can have see which domains they have updated the certificates as well. Like Let's Encrypt recently started supporting wildcard domains. So people started using rather than disclosing their subdomains, right? If you rather than going and making a HTTPS certificate for blog.buckroad.com, they kind of put star.buckroad.com, but it has again its own negatives, disadvantages as well. So this kind of discloses some of the information which kind of gives the visibility for the attacker's point of view as well. So we are parsing these logs again. So as I said in the beginning, we will be using Beats. Beats is kind of data shipper, like which will help you to parse, send those logs from one location to the ELK stack. So if you see here the configuration, yeah. So we kind of have a different kind of inputs. We are tagged here saying that search stream, so that the log will, whenever it reads, it will go and make sure if it matches search stream, then it will perform those filter patterns. And similarly, we are using ScanSivo for the another data set we will be looking at the next scenario. So we will be using tags called ScanSivo. So the output will be ending up in the localhost 5044, which is the Logstash running place. So once we have logs and the received everything, we kind of use Kibana. Kibana is like looks like this. It's a fancy dashboard using AngularJS. So what it does is whenever we made a query using curl localhost 9200, so this is similarly, it will talk to the Elasticsearch API and gets the data back and try to put it in a visualized format like graphs, like similarly like this or some other. So I'll quickly cover how to use this Kibana in the coming section, not now. I'm going to skip for this now because if you understand this, it kind of help you to put the data in a proper format and showcase you to answer some kind of questions, right? So we'll get started with our first scenario. So it's kind of now basically I get involved into ELK 101 I covered so that you can able to get and use your own data sets if you have any apart from the scenarios. So in the first scenario, we kind of looking at mainly the certificate transparency logs, and we wanted to monitor for an organization if any new certificate generated for their domains or subdomains, right? And for this scenario, what we have done is the one thing as we stated in the abstract, saying that in near real time. So we kind of not did for this the workshop because it's kind of taking half an hour to get that certificate into the log in the certificate transparency log whenever it generated a Let's Encrypt certificate. So what we have done is we have already created that previously certificates and we took the data samples, but we kind of show you the how to run your own server as well as how you can get those data sets as well to the JSON, right? So you can go ahead and read more about like the details of certificate transparency log, how it works and everything. They have documented each and everything here. So we will be mainly using the certificate transparency logs using a service which we are running, which is by CaliDog. I'll just showcase. So there is a script we have created, custom scripts. What it does is it will go ahead and look for the certificates is any generated by the service which we are running, and it will go ahead and write into a JSON format so that we can directly pass into the ELK stack, right? So this is a very simple Python code. What it does is, should I zoom in? So what it does is there is a Docker container to start the services for the Python for the CaliDog server, which will keep listening for the certificates which are generated throughout the certificate transparency logs from crd.sh. So once it writes, it's listening on the localhost 4000 server, the Docker container. So it will go ahead and make a WebSocket call and keep writing those data into the JSON file. Okay, so that JSON file looks like what we have seen similar. The one which we have seen using JQ. So this is the output from that service. So if you wanted to go back and try, basically what we have to do is you just run the search stream server, which is a Docker container, and we have created a documentation in README how to run that service. So once you have run the service, you kind of started a server to listen for all the certificate transparency logs. Then you kind of use the client to store and send it back to the log stash. Right. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You mean to say different kind of transparency logs states, like places?
Well, so that one Docker server, is it, would you only aim it at bug crowd and it would monitor?
No. Yeah, to answer your question, so that looks for all the certificate transparency logs which are generated. Means it's throughout the internet. It's not for the only specific to the domain. That is what your question is. It's not for saying that only bugcrowd.com or defcon.org. It's kind of look for the internet wide, like completely.
So, certificate transparency log is essentially get populated whenever you register a new SSL TLS certificate. When you buy a certificate, the participating CA, which is saying information that you bought the certificate through a log, that log is what the search stream server reads. So every single certificate that is issued on the internet, not only that, but that was the example that we used. From the cert SSH side, right? Cert SSH is an interface to search through certificate log, right? And it's a goldmine for attackers. It was down until yesterday.
Yeah. So we kind of set it up. That is the reason the CaliDog server Docker container, rather than depending on them. What it does is it is not only look for CRT.sh, it's kind of look at Google transparency log. Facebook has similarly a certificate transparency log. Yeah. So it kind of different places to look. If it one server down also, it's kind of load balancer. It will go and talk to the another one and get the logs.
The interesting bit is that if you have internal applications not visible on the internet, like corporate applications within an environment that are not visible to the internet, but if you obtain an SSL TLS certificate at some point in time, they will, their internal domain name will come up in search. So if you search for a large organization like Accenture or IBM, you will see a lot of internal domains that are not accessible from the internet.
Yeah.
But for an attacker, it's information.
Yes.
Who registered for the search? How closely are they checking that you are who you say you are? So I'm registering an ABC company. Do they do a verification check like they do with Liz? Not all Liz information.
They don't give you who is information, the certificate?
Not giving you who is information, but what verification are they doing to make sure that you are who you claim?
Okay, when generating a certificate. So there are two ways to generate with Let's Encrypt. One is DNS-based challenge, second one is HTTP-based challenge. So either you have to point your DNS record, basically saying that a record is going to point to this IP address. So that is the one verification. Another way is DNS challenge. So there are two ways they will verify.
They ask you to upload a file and they'll verify the file is there. But the interesting bit, right, with certificate transparency logs is the reason it was created, because a lot of CAs in the past have been hacked. Like Wikimator got hacked and their certificate is used to sign phishing domains. Right? So this is certificate transparency logs. As an organization, you can monitor the logs to see if any certificates are issued for your domain. That you are on
the web. Yeah, it's kind of showcasing your posture.
The first scenario.
Yeah. So as I said, like previously, it's not only CRT.sh. It's kind of looks for different places. The Kali Dark server, which the Docker container one. So it is like Facebook also runs their own certificate transparency log program. Like if you can give same buckroad.com here. So it's kind of go ahead and perform the same CRT.sh. Like you can see like all the subdomains which are related to background, which are generated and all the details as well. Like it's not only one server, like one people maintain. So Google has their own as well similarly. And I think we have put it in the references section where you can go back and read more about it and use different places. But in terms of 2 hours workshop, we could have not showing all the stuff. Yeah, sorry for that. Cool. So it's kind of like once we have got the data, like as you have seen, like the search stream. So, sorry.
How often does that service check in?
Which service?
Okay,
so this will be keep looking for the certificates, but the time it is taking when we did the demonstration, like to get the certificate, kind of took like 15 to 20 minutes to receive the certificate to the logs. But the Facebook has really interesting feature where you can see that you have a domain, you can go ahead and subscribe to that domain. Whenever you get new certificate for any subdomains of the domain, also you'll get a mail alert so that you can make sure that there is a our subdomains are captured. And if someone creates a new organization without your notification, so then you can know that there is a certificate generated, someone has created a subdomain or something else. So if you go here Facebook, they have a subscription, you can go ahead and create a subscription based on the domain. They kind of go ahead and send that the email. That is answer. Cool. So once we have got the data, so we kind of currently already sent the data to Kibana, Elasticsearch. So Kibana is a front end which will go ahead and query that and get back the data, right? So if you see here, we kind of using tags to differentiate currently. I'll just refresh. So we are have like a different data logs because we for this next scenario also we already imported because of the time intention. So you can see those logs coming in here whenever you get the alerts or like whichever generated from the certificate transparency logs. So you can use this the filters, especially in Kibana, to query those or to make it granular to whatever the results which we wanted to see. Because it looks for the entire world, right, internet. So we don't want to look for entire internet. So, this can be done in two ways. The best way to do this may be at logstash level. You can put tags saying that if matches to our domain, then only send it to Elasticsearch so that you kind of reducing your amount of data sets and you can easy to make it parsing and all stuff. Or if you miss out there, you can have used Kibana filters to do that as well. So I'll go ahead and apply the tags saying that make sure I wanted to see loss. Again, I'll increase the font. Forgot. So tags is I'm looking for search stream logs only. So as we used in file bit saying the tagging feature, so we kind of leverage that to use filtering. So we're using tagging to make sure only look for the certificate transparency logs now. So whenever you apply filter, like you see 11,000 hits, now you can see 1,227, right? It's kind of filtered down to the particular logs which you wanted to see in Kibana. And if you see the example JSON document, like that stores in a JSON format, it's kind of parses for you the entire JSON. I'll increase the font. It's super slow because it's the Elasticsearch and Logstash runs on Java, so like it's in their memory. So if you see that JSON, it's kind of automatically parses the JSON for you fields, so you can use like a key value pairs queries, like whenever you wanted to make APIs as well. So it will parse entire JSON, whichever the keychain, data keychain, and all the domain names which are part of this. Like as I said, it looks for all the domains throughout the internet. Some of the domain came as part of while we are running the scan. So also it looks for which kind of the digital signature and who is the owner, like Let's Encrypt or DigiCert or whoever it is created. And the source name, as I said, it kind of looks for different data sources. So one is Google. So we are kind of getting from Google or gone to the 18 logs, like the log which is coming from that certificate transparency log. And this is the log entry looks like. So this is like pretty similar to what we have seen in the JSON, but it's kind of parsed structured way so that we can able to query. I'll reduce it. So now what is main interesting stuff here is once we have captured the data, we have identified the data source, now we have placed the data which is in our visualization platform. The final thing is interesting to look to us is querying the data sets and making sure taking certain actions on top of it, right? So as I explained in the beginning, we will be using ElastAlert. So we kind of created an ElastAlert rule, which I'll again show you. So it looks similar to this. So whenever you see a new certificate for this, this looks for the particular file beat index, because the index, if you see in the Kibana, the name of this index is file beat. So we are saying that if any logs receive in this index and it matches the time frame or whatever the reasons which you wanted to apply the filter, suppose you may wanted to look for a different kind of patterns, right? And then also you can use these queries, the one which you made using filters in the Kibana. This is same, I am saying tags is search stream, which is the filter which you see here. This one, you can also apply here tags is search stream, sorry, spelling mistake. The same query. So this is, uses Apache Lucene, which is a backend querying thing for the Elasticsearch. So we will be using these queries to make the alerting, and currently we are looking for the iatf.org on the wildcard applies here. Like it looks for all different kind of subdomains rather than looking for the particular domain, and whenever it matches we kind of send a Slack alert. So rather than Slack alert, you kind of send go ahead and create a Jira ticket to whoever the ops team or admin team or security team, saying that new certificate has been generated. Is this part of your the inventory or like a CMDB, like configuration management database, right? So once it has done, we kind of look for the patterns here. So this is where we kind of make interesting in terms of data sets. So we can go ahead and look for different kind of patterns, especially the primary reason is meant for the alerting feature. We kind of took this scenario, but not only that, we kind of go ahead and look for subdomains as well. So it makes it more easier, especially here. So I'll go ahead and open already saved search. I kind of created a search so that easy to show rather than building here. So basically what we are doing is we are trying to take whatever the parameters which we wanted to show in the data sets so that we can only look for the granular data sets. So here I can go ahead and run that query saying that I wanted to look for the certain domain. So if you see here the query, we are looking for the jira.insecure.dns. Right. So whenever you see any instance a certificate has been generated for this query, we kind of go ahead and see that it has been issued a new certificate. and this is the DNS record, and the other information, if you want to drill down, you can just go ahead and click this icon, and it will give you complete JSON output of that particular certificate, and you can see that it is generated by which time and what are the different resources regarding to that, right? So this is one way, and I can also use like wildcard to look at all the subdomains related to the organizations, right? This kind of gives you more different results based on the use case. So the main focus of the certificate transparency logs to look at here is to monitor for any new certificates has been generated, or like to look for unknown like generation of your organization members, right? But we kind of moving to the second scenario now. Yes.
So, how do we find out a different domain name under the same company? Sometimes we found a new product was released, and they used different URL. The same company. How do we find out?
So you mean to say similar URL patterns are like a subdomains? Different domain itself, you mean to say? Yeah, like abc.com means like abce.com, like that.
Like Facebook and Instagram, okay,
gotcha. So these kind of things, I think you can't get from the certificate transparency logs until unless they kind of use same CSERT and using all domains, whatever they have as a single certificate they are generating, like their own. And if you wanted to look at those areas, maybe you wanted to get an inventory from your DNS, like whoever the name registrar, like a name chief or the Gandhi. So you can kind of use those data source and already make queries already in Elast Alert. So whenever you make for those domains, you can have get alert. So you have to make the inventory and put it in already alerting system. So inventory has to be there. Like otherwise we kind of looking for the entire internet, right? That's the only thing. The similar domains, you mean to say the, oh, that is the third scenario I'll be going to cover. Good. So the intention is like mainly to take it forward in terms of making sure you are looking as a defensive way and as well as offensive way. So I kind of mostly done with the demonstration. I'll just quickly show you internet-wide, because we are looking at currently only organization level. If you wanted to look at scale, the how it kind of helps certificate transparency logs.
Okay.
Riaz is giving swags and stuff for the questions and cool. Please give feedback. Like if you see any useful features from the data sets, it might be good to let us know. Like we kind of use and try to put it back in the documentation. So we kind of written a simple CTLog utilities using Python script. What it does is you kind of go ahead and give the CA by cert. Okay, I just need to pip env install, it's Python shell. Okay, so what we are doing is we are trying to get the certificates based on the entire CA search with the internet scale. So what it does is you can go ahead and, it's already running
internet.
Yeah, it's stuck. Yeah, so super slow. I'll just quickly show the, how it looks like. It looks like this. So what it does is it looks at internet scale. Like if you see this certificate authority has generated these many certs at internet scale, and like a cPanel Komodo has these many certs generated in the internet scale. And it's not only useful in that way, and you can also use for organization level like similar scripts, which is, you can say that buckroad.com says that Let's Encrypt has this generated these many certificates for that buckroad.com, right? You can also look at like different ways to use these data sets and get some information out of your organizations using certificate transparency logs. So before moving to the second scenario, is there any questions regarding this? Yes. Yes. HTTP, no, because the certificate transparency logs is meant to look for the... Oh, you mean to say this? Okay. Yeah, you can have used Subfinder. There are so many subdomain finding tools. I think if you... You can go to our blog.appseco.com. There is a really good blog about pen tester. What is that? OSINT. Pen tester guide to subdomains. That is like more interesting in terms of like finding subdomains. Yeah, I'll zoom in once I'll get the results. Still. Yeah. So people use that.
Virus tool also use. We have a bunch of services. We've actually written two blog posts on our company website.
So
one is specifically on using new innovative techniques on finding subdomains. Right.
I think my internet is super slow.
And he's done that at several
background
conferences also in the past.
Yeah, Level Up. He has done a bunch of...
Level Up. He delivered it there. Right? So, and that's one. And there's another blog post we have written as a 101 for people getting started in Recon. Right? So, there's a 101 post on information gathering. And that's also there on the... We put both of them as references. But we just search for... If you go to the blog.appseco.com website, website,
and we have created a cheat sheet as well, I think. Fancy. For finding the same thing.
So, I was in a Jason
Harris,
and he was using
AMAS
and Subfinder.
Yeah, Subfinder is the one which is written in Golang. You kind of use the binary and you can specify that which one you wanted to use, and it'll go ahead and find based on the all. Ways like it can use like virus total, it can use like the passive DNS, and also you can give your Shodan keys, API keys it supports, and it'll go ahead and find. Yeah, this is the one Subfinder. So you can just say that like whatever the thing which you wanted to look, it has like different configurations which you wanted to specify using brute force dictionary. So it kind of does that for you. Cool. Like my internet is slow, I think. Cool. So we will be looking at the scenario 2 now. It's mainly focusing on monitoring part rather than looking at alerting and other things. And we will be looking at mainly to focus on two things. One is, as I said, the Cloudflare. If you use it, it's kind of gives you a list of subdomains for the domain which you have given. But people who ever use Cloudflare, they may not really reveal their own IP address, right? So many people struggle, like if you got a pen test or like the finding, they are behind a Cloudflare. I don't even know what is IP address, right? So the DNS sets, especially by this forward DNS sets by Rapid7, there is a project called Sonar by scans.io, which is, so what it does is it kind of collects entire internet-wide scans, especially for the different kind of records, like a IPv6, AAA, and NS records, and other each text records, MS records. So what we have done is we kind of took a trimmed version of dataset because of the demonstration. Otherwise, it's like 300 plus GB of datasets they have, which we couldn't be able to fit in the VMs. So we will be using the trimmed version of the datasets to kind of how you can use those datasets to kind of look at your external posture of organization in terms of security, in terms of like the infrastructure which you have out there. You want to add anything? So yeah, I think it's they always release off monthly, I think once, that same data set. The problem with them is like they kind of release the entire data set again rather than releasing the diff which has been done. So it's kind of difficult to do that. And if you wanted to know more, like dig into deep, I think they have done a pretty good research in and put it in a documentation we have referenced where they kind of explain more how they collect these data sets and the scans as well. Okay, so what we have done is again for this scenario, we kind of already this is already captured data sets which are available at Rapid7 scans.io website. If you go here,
looks like super. So, how many of you use internet here? No one. So I'll just quickly show the data sets. I think it's already downloaded and locally set it up in the VM. But if you wanted to go back and look at the website is here. You can just Google for Rapid7 the FDNS data sets. It will be there. So this has different types of records which are like the IPv4, IPv6 text, CNAME, as well as any records. So we have captured those records and kept in the VM. Like if you see here in the so this is how it looks like, the data set. So what it contains is it's kind of timestamp and the name of the record, which may be domain name or the IP address and the value, and the type of record, maybe NS, TXT or SOA, the records which are any different types of records. And they have also segregated based on the type of record. If you want, like you wanted to only look at A records, so they kind of set that data set as well. And so it's already by default in JSON. So what we have done is similarly again sending it to Logstash and Elasticsearch and get into the Kibana.
Right.
So once we have this data set, the primary reason to look at this data set is huge, as it similar to certificate transparency log. So it's not only for the specific domain, it kind of looks at internet scale. So it has like the whatever the data which is available in the internet.
So once we have parsed the data set using the
so extra feature, as I said, we will be using GeoIP filter. So because of the value which is there, so we also added the GeoIP database for IPv6 as well. So what it kind of does is for IPv6 also, it will go ahead and give you the details. So if I go ahead and change this filter to the scan size, I'll just increase the font. 1 second.
So this is the data set which we have taken a trimmed version, which has like 10,000 records. But it, if you wanted to parse like entire data set, you can also parse. It's kind of support ELK stack at scale. So you can use like terabytes of data as well to parse.
So once we have done that data parsing, so it's kind of gives you complete visibility of the information. Like as I said, it's kind of go ahead and gets the information about the GeoIP. Like you kind of see which location where the data set has the IP address has been triggered, like Singapore, and the IP information. Each and every detail has been come because of the Logstash enrichment. And people also use alternatively like a FluentD. It is similar to Logstash if you wanted to familiar with and try it out.
So once we have this data set, we kind of mainly focusing on trying to showcase those visualizations, so that rather than looking at a single time, like if you wanted to keep looking at as a fancy SOC or NOC dashboards, whenever something happens and kind of builds those visualization to represent, is there any new domain has arrived or subdomains has been captured.
So I'll quickly showcase that the dashboard, like it looks like this. It's rendering slowly.
So it's kind of looks like this. So what we have, I'll just quickly go back and show how I have built visualization so that you can try out for other data sets as well and based on your use case. But to highlight the main things here is we kind of look for different kind of records which we wanted to look at. Like is there any A records or like the AA records or like a TXT based on the use case. And we kind of map with the location which it is generated from using a GeoIP map, which is again available in the Kibana. So that is the one of the reason we picked. And also we kind of plot those data in the graph, which kind of shows like which type of records has been coming so many for these organizations, right?
So at the end, again, the entire data will be available as a JSON format, so that if you wanted to go back and drill down in terms of subdomain ways or like a more granular way of the particular JSON record. So if you see this, for example, rather than going and looking for the everything, so I just wanted to go ahead and look for the particular domain. So if you see here, whenever I search the filter for the name icon.org, so it will go ahead and apply those same query to the entire visualizations. So this can be run in whatever the alerting as well, if you wanted to go back and send the data which is coming out there. So here, if I go ahead and unmouse over, seeing that this is the A record, I can go ahead and click that apply filter. So it will apply that filter here. And the data which is coming is only specific to the A records which are created for your organizations, right? So whenever you see here, the count increases, basically there is a new A record added for your DNS entry based from the forward DNS logs. And it kind of gives you which country they are creating. If your organization is like across the world, like it has like different places, people using the data centers. And the apart from the main thing is here, we kind of look at subdomains for those as well. Like if anyone using same A record to create multiple subdomains, like I kind of use Jira and CRM here, cricket, INT, VIP. So these all may be pointing to the same IP as well. So you kind of use correlations capability of Kibana to make sure and look at the certain patterns as well using these kind of visualizations, right? So I'll switch back to one more level and try to show you how this visualization has been created, just to give you overview so that you can go back and try for different data sets, especially if you are looking for the subdomains. Maybe you are like using services like Subfinder that will give you at the end JSON. You can go back and use these kind of features to look at the posture, right? So the data is by default available in the search patterns. So once it has done the searches, we kind of use visualization to represent those data, whichever has been produced. So Kibana has very friendly interface, but I think it's very difficult if you wanted to try out first time. But if you like look some videos, tutorials or two times, it's very easy to showcase the data which is available and most of the data science team. And if you heard about Mozilla entire defensive platform runs on ELK stack, like entire their SOC team and Black Hat, I think DEFCON, they are a SOC also will use these kind of visualization because the amount of the data it can support is like the scalability issue. So we will be using different kind of graphs to showcase, like we have created a already existing graphs as well. Like if you see here, I'll just show the existing one. Pie chart, like the scan cyber based on the country. So it's kind of ask you based on which type of events you wanted to create the graph. Like we are trying to say that terms means like whichever the field you wanted to select to showcase there. So we wanted to select the keyword type means like which type of record it has been created. So whenever you have applied, you can give how many values it has to represent in this pie chart. So we'll go ahead and apply this field. So if you rather for 10, you can go ahead and apply 5. So it kind of reflects that data in near real time. So this is the one way to showcase and people has built like complex visualizations. If you see their tutorials and things, so where it kind of gives you more granular visibility, like if you wanted to apply based on the type of record and if it matches to certain IP address, then it will show the visualization. So it kind of gives you the especially business people management. So okay, this many of the organization posture has been mapped to this IP, the subdomains, right? So there are a bunch of other visualizations as well. I think we kind of already created a pretty good dashboards for this other scenarios as well. So what we have done is rather than going and teaching the Kibana, we kind of put references to the Kibana tutorials if you wanted to try out. And another thing what we have done is this entire dashboard can be exported as a single JSON file. If you wanted to upload for your own dataset, you can go ahead and import that JSON file. It will be here. If you go to the last management section and here saved objects, you can just click on the import and use this the scan cyber Kibana. It will automatically render that dashboard based on this datasets for any of the scan cyber stuff. I'll just keep because it's already there.
So this is the main one of the use case, but people has extensively used this data logs to showcase like a different use cases, especially not only with the forward DNS. They kind of use forward DNS data set with their own internal passive DNS. So if you use your own internal passive DNS, you kind of use these logs with by correlating with the forward DNS data set to make sure that the alert is not false positive or some kind of thing, so that they can ensure that the result is the true value. Any questions before moving to the third scenario on the next section?
You could do that if you have both the data sets available. Most of this visualization requires you to have the data set. The intelligence only comes up with maybe the GUIP and other things. But if you provide the data set, you can easily correlate it.
So for example, if you have acquisition, like Google has recently acquired, like suppose, what is that coming? Dropcam or something, like long ago, sorry. So you can have go back and look at, you have to write some kind of custom programming still, because we don't know whether it is acquired or not. If you have that information, we kind of use the correlation engine, which is again in Logstash and Kibana, to ensure that if it is related to this, then it can show in the certain organization level as well. So this can the amount of the information which can be showcased, it is very powerful if you have kind of data sets which are available to use that information.
And the way you would integrate a new data set would be through this correlation engine in Logstash?
Yes, using Logstash, yeah. So that is the reason we just quickly went through in the beginning. But if you wanted to know more about like how we kind of use different data sets, we have referenced the way how we can go back and read more about it.
This is just one of the data sets that Sona has. In my opinion, it's one of the most judicious, one of the biggest projects undertaken on the internet in terms of scanning for data. Because this is, our DNS is one data set. They have a reverse DNS data set as well. They have HTTP data sets. And they have an SSL data set. They have tons of those data sets which allow them, you know, all of the data you can visualize. You can create the powerful set attribution.
Any feedback to improve in terms of like the data set? Like, is there any other ways you people use like to look at like the external infrastructure posture? Like, what kind of data might be useful to showcase here? Yes. Okay. You mean to say who is data set?
Sorry.
You mean to say who? Okay. Okay. Cool. Okay. Gotcha. Yeah. So what he's trying saying is makes sense. Actually, what we can do is like if you have found a domain or something, we can go back and query the who is information for the domain. We'll get back the who is the information like contact, technical information, and the phone number or email ID. If you use that again, you kind of use some other plugin to enrich that data. And you can go back and showcase a reverse point to that. Is there any more data available? It's kind of going like a nested, but it's kind of give more drill down information, like how multiple source, like if you go and click and showcase. But yeah, it can be done, I think, but it has to be put some work, but that will be great to see, like to go back.
DNS data is easy to visualize because it's public. You can't hide away record.
Yeah. People sometimes who is users, they kind of protect their who is record information as well, like
so
the buyer.
Give you privacy card and other such features that allow you to hide those information. Even for ISP, nominate for example in the UK, whose information wouldn't be made public unless you're part of the nominated group and then they allow you to download those. So there are these additional constraints that come up. DNS data is definitely open to everybody.
Yeah. But yeah, that one is good. Like actually we kind of enrich the stuff. Cool. Anything else before moving on? So as I said, like in the beginning, if you kind of use people the older ways, like they have migrated from the servers to Cloudflare, they kind of not able to get IP. The forward DNS dataset may have historical data. If you kind of download full 320 GB of dataset, you can able to see the old IP addresses mapped to the domains as well. Yeah, we kind of used in one of our engagement pen testing, the kind of behind Cloudflare, we kind of used our forward DNS dataset to query that particular IP, which is the old IP, still they point to the same IP. So they kind of use useful information while doing testing.
You were able to attack the application which was behind Cloudflare using the IP.
Yeah. Cool. So that is one of the most thing. So then we will move on to the section, the third scenario, where I think he's asked previously, is there any way to see the phishing domains, like similarly domains? So this is a scenario which we wanted to focus on that area, because I think Facebook has started extensive research on this. They have a similar project on the similar areas. They are also looking at CT logs. Based on if you see any similar kind of DNS twisted domain, they kind of report back to the team, like to make sure that the Facebook, this is not the Facebook domain or something. Otherwise, people go ahead and click that and give the password. They got phishing has been done easily using those kind of domains. So for this scenario, we kind of using a data source by thing called against certificate transparency log to look at bunch of stuff, but it may not to be, but in this scenario we will be using, but I'll showcase where you can go back and try out other ways, like a different log set as well. So what we have doing is we kind of again loading the certificate transparency log. So we mainly using a library called DNS twist. It's a Python base. I'll just see if it works. Yeah, I think my internet is back. Cool. So it's a Python project in GitHub. Like what it does is it kind of looks for the similar any domains available in the internet. So if you say like buckroad.com, as we saw from the beginning, so it figures out is there any similar domain which is available in the internet, like buckroad.go, like that, or any. I'll just go ahead and run for the one domain.
If internet is back. What domain do you have?
Yes.
It's three letters. There's not a lot of combinations. You can't play around with too many characters.
I'll zoom in. Give me a second.
Microsoft. For my question.
Yeah, makes sense. What is that?
Yeah. So it's going to try and figure out based on those.
So the input is -l list. What is the domain you said?
Microsoft.
Microsoft.com. Oh, it already did that. So I'll just parse it using JQ fancy tool. So you can see it has different kind of subdomains. Sorry, different kind of domains which are similar to Microsoft domain. If you see here, this uses like what is this language? Like which country? Okay. Maybe, yeah. So what people does is like they kind of use different kind of ways to represent also. In browser, they don't go and see URL, like copy paste and see the text also, right? So it looks Microsoft, but you see O on top of that. So this is the data which can be come from the DNS twist. So what it does is the given a domain for your organization, it kind of finds related domains different ways. If you see this one, this is homoglyph, the one I think it should see like insertion, like if you see Microsoft, M-I-K-Microsoft, right? So like a different possible and the combinations it will try, and something which is very nice if you say omission as well, like if it will just remove one kind of letter or something from the domain name to make it look similar. So and also it gives the information with all the list of domains possible related to that. So you kind of use this inventory to go back and look at is there any similar phishing domain has been created, and someone is using this to mimic basically our organization, or like used to do some kind of spam, or like especially this is kind of data sets people look in fraud detection teams. If you have like fraud detection teams in your organizations, like especially large e-commerce companies, they kind of heavily depends on these kind of things, because they kind of use to go and check out this using this link, photos you can download like that. So
there's an interesting flag that DNS mistake is called -r, I think it is.
Is it?
Yeah. Which actually goes and checks, remember the JQ, which actually go and verify if the domain is registered or not.
Oh.
So from an attacker point of view, if you're rating in company, it'll actually tell you which of these are available. You can go and register.
Yeah.
The other way around. So that is probably useful.
This one, I think, yeah, the command. Actually, the same people, I think, kind of built a fancy website as well, DNS twist dot report.
Twister
dot report. Yeah, this one. So, the same what Ria said command, it's kind of use a option here. If I say Microsoft.com, it will go ahead and look for the domains available. And it will say this is your original. It kind of gives you IP information. Again, you can go back and send it to your logstash to enrich the data where it is has been created and all the stuff. And it not only does that, you can, as iPhone R flag, it kind of shows unresolved the stuff which is able to resolve or not resolve for the domain which has been there, right? So this is the data set which we were playing with the third scenario, especially looking at the phishing campaigns has been created for your organization by someone. And the Facebook has similar project. I think we have put it in the references section where they have working on similar areas to look for anyone has been created a spam detection for them. So similarly, we will be using for this as well, like the certificate transparency logs to look, is there anyone for our organization has been created a certificate for one of our the similar looking domain, like phishing domain by DNS twist. So first, what we have to do is we kind of get the data set using the DNS twists. So this script does that automatically. So we kind of put this script in our code when we distribute. Yeah. So the output of this the DNS twist file will be sent it back to again logstash and vice versa to ELK and the Kibana. So what we have to do is extra feature apart from the first scenario and the second scenario, we kind of get all the certificate transparency logs using the certificate transparency log that script and the service. So once we have get the all certificate transparency log, the pattern which we wanted to look is not only for the our organization, so we kind of look for all different kind of possible ways to look for the similar domains. So if you look at one example, we have created a thing. So in the first scenario, I think we have used this. So if you see insecure DNS, we kind of create this domain owned by us, the insecure DNS. So if you see insecure DNS, there is a jira.insecure.dns.com. Like the domain which has been created, I'll just zoom in. This one. So similarly, what we have done is we kind of bought another domain looking similar to the insecure DNS, but here we are just trying to remove the D, basically insecure NS. So if you go ahead and run the similar query for the thing. So if you see here, payment.insecureNS.com. But if you see, there is a D missing here, insecure DNS. But someone has generated a certificate for our payment server, which is publicly available. They may be trying to legitimately sending to some other people or customers, whoever uses this organization, right? So using these kind of log data sets, which are available publicly and looking for this kind of things may give more visibility in terms of what kind of things has been happening to your organization in terms of external the posture, right? So this is the one way to look. We are still working on making sure that the DNS twist records data set will be coming back to logstash to enrich. And I think as someone mentioned, we may work on that as well, like looking who is information and getting back into the logstash to make sure go back and drill down. So what we are trying to do here is once it has been received, we kind of creating elast alerts against same patterns using the elast alert rule set. So if it matches any of our DNS test records for the certain domain for our organization, so we kind of go ahead and send an alert to the ops team saying that do we own this domain,
So if this is yes, it's kind of our own domain. So if it is not part of our inventory, we may want to go ahead and take action, saying that sending an email to our one of the customers team marketing, saying that if you see anyone sees the domain naming coming similar to this area, please do not click or use that. At least it kind of helps saying that disclosing point of view, right? Is there any questions in terms of this scenario or like the data sets, any feedback? So Facebook is working on similar, sorry?
Have you encountered any real world phishing campaigns back at your organization?
So how many of you run phishing campaigns at least for your organization? Like not you, like at least your teams? Yeah.
One thing you could do too is take the permutations mm-hmm. and put them into the blog list of your email gateway.
Yeah.
That way you don't have to worry about it.
So the problem with those things, it only works for your organization level, but what about your customers, right? So that is where we wanted to look at transparency logs so that we can see at internet scale and look for send it back. But yeah, that is really good. If you wanted to block it local things, corporate level, yeah, it's really good way to approach. Mm-hmm. Yeah, virus total or something like that, you mean to say? Huh? Oh, okay, you mean to say the people who has done that? Oh, okay. So what if it is legitimate domain there, someone organization is using? Yeah. Classification maybe, yeah.
Yeah,
that is for sure.
Internally, you would verify before using code. This could simply be a legitimate system.
Yeah.
That reminds me of that very ancient, there was a particular case that Microsoft, again with Microsoft, there was a chap from Micro, it's a very old story. Have you heard of that? There's a young 15-year-old developer called Micro, his name was MIKEROWE, and he used to write code. So he created a website called Microsoft. It was a legit site. He was trying to advertise his code, but Microsoft kind of tried to shut him down, and he filed a lawsuit against Microsoft, and he won the case. And so that's a real legit example of how you could look at a phishing campaign or domain, but it turns out that there's somebody else who owns the business. Like defcon.com is a website. It's not us. It's not them here. Right? It's actually defcon.
Not all.
Somebody else is running defcon.com.
Exactly. Yeah.
You would have to validate and verify somewhere.
So I think that is where more automation kicks in place. Like if you use phantom JS like things, like you kind of look for these domains and take a picture of the homepage and compare with your like Google has releasing AutoML, if you know. So what they are trying to do is still in beta, I think. So you can have upload both all the images which are there. So it kind of classifies based on the category. So maybe you can kind of use these scenarios and go ahead and take all the PhantomJS. Actually, Firefox support now headless. You can go ahead and run that script in the automated way. So it'll take all screenshots for your phishing domains and compares with your main domain. If it matches using AutoML, kind of go and report that. It's kind of automation. Cool. Which one? Oh, okay. Yeah. It's like it's kind of interesting to see so much stuff around this area because it's kind of more security work, but it's kind of more has to be put in terms of thinking wise, like how people innovatively come up with the phishing campaigns or like new ways to attack. Yeah.
Between two time snapshots,
I didn't get. Sorry.
Is there a way to query between two time snapshots? Like
So historical data, you mean to say, like old data set and the new one, you mean to say? Yeah. It is possible. So the last alert, I think I'll just go back to that slide just to showcase. Yeah. So what it does is it has a different way to look at this thing. So if you see one of them thing is like the change feature is looks from the previous data set, the timestamp. And if anything apart from that, something looks newer than the previous anomalies, it's kind of make an alert. So it will look at the whole data set. You can define which timestamp to look. Like I can look for past 6 months, and if it doesn't match from the past 6 months similar area of patterns, it will go in and alert also as well. So it can the problem with especially using open source solutions, it's kind of need to be built so much the fine tuning. But once you have place fine tuning, it kind of works at scale and customization. But purchasing product is like, yeah, you just go and talk to the team marketing stuff. Yeah. Yes.
Like 8 years back, I used to do the Google Docs. I used to do the command line and automate it to get essentially files.
Yes.
Now many tools available, you don't have to do all the
things. Oh, you mean to say for getting the data?
Yeah. Have a subdomain and then look for sensitive data exposure using Google Docs.
Oh, okay. So you are saying that use Google Docs to find subdomains or any sensitive data available using like index.off or file extensions,
yeah.
Those things. Yeah.
All that. Like,
yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I think this is the one now. I got internet. I'll just go back and show. So this is one of the popular blog which we have written and across internet buzzing. So this is, I think, if you are more interested in especially finding subdomain enumeration, we kind of wrote a blog post like the how it kind of can perform subdomain enumeration for different ways. So the one way is kind of looking at techniques using Google Docking, as he mentioned.
Yeah.
So what we can do is you can use different kind of site operators to look at like what are the different types of subdomain, like store, UK, jobs, and different ways like you can get this. And people has written scripts like Reconng, one of the framework for the Recon. So they also use similar techniques to do that as well. And the people also use Google, but there are so many other search engines out there which can also give results. Like Bing, it's really good if you wanted to look at subdomain enumeration.
That's the only time you can use.
Yeah. Kind of see, you can get like juicy information like Slack, Jira, what do you want? The second thing is like we have kind of focused on VirusTotal. As people keep updating, uploading files and information, people also capture the metadata, nothing but like the file owner information, the file, the downloaded URLs, like as a reference if you use some kind of URL. So these all has been captured as a metadata part. So this kind of gives subdomains as well. Like you can see like for Wikipedia, you can have see huge amount of subdomains which are from this. And the third thing is we use dumpster, DNS dumpster, where it kind of gives the different subdomains and put it in a geographical map saying that which is map, like how we saw in the Kibana previously, it kind of enriched the data information. And as someone mentioned, I think he mentioned saying that sublister is again one of the thing, like similar to subfinder. So it can go ahead and look at Baidu, Yahoo, Google, Bing, different search engines, as well as the passive DNS, and also it looks at SSL certificate, which is certificate transparency logs again, and it kind of give you complete information about the domains we have found from those as well. And like the certificate transparency logs, this we have looked in the scenario one as well. Like this is another way to look at subdomains if you wanted more interested. And as I said, they kind of give you Postgres interface to query. This is the script, and if you go to our blog post, we have kind of given the script to make and use for your organizations.
Yeah.
And another thing is DNS Recon. This is again kind of brute force and look at different ways to go back and find subdomains. And it uses bunch of other ways. I think so many other as there, like it's kind of huge workshop itself finding subdomains. Right.
We happily when during an assessment, if you're doing a pen test, Absolute does a lot of consulting work as well. If you're doing a pen test, we spend a considerable amount of time.
Yeah, we can have.
Because we believe that one tiny flaw that is going to deteriorate is out there.
I just wanted to highlight this part, like because if you've seen in the second scenario, we're kind of using FDNS set. So if we have compared different data sets, and FDNS has a huge amount of data set which has given subdomains, because it kind of stores entire historical internet level data sets, rather than looking at certain tool, it gives more visibility across the data set. So that is one of the reason we picked the data set for FDNS. And the thing is, like, we have created a cheat sheet. If you wanted to go back and try out, feel free to do. We will be here as well, like, if you want to talk to us and ask any questions. So, moving on. So this is the one scenario which we wanted to cover for the last part, and what we have seen is mainly focusing on looking for the phishing domains. And as so many gave feedback, we kind of update any of the things which we can try to use, like Whois datasets, and compare it and correlate to showcase any data which can be possibly legitimate or not. And the thing is, we kind of not able to put like the time to make sure everyone has to do here, like for the workshop. But as we said, like we kind of make this update the Gitbook with each step by step screenshot as well. We kind of tweet from the Recon Village or our AppSeco account. You can like get entire the Gitbook and the VM. Go ahead and feel free to try whatever the stuff. And please add your own data sets if you find, and try out like how you can correlate and get more value out of this. And if you have any questions, please let us know. Then we kind of showcase the references part before concluding the workshop, so that you can go back and try other ways to look at the same data sets to take it forward. Any questions?
She's got
oh, yes.
For DNS twist, you said you can use the tap R to see if it's been registered.
Yes.
Does it give that information on
who registered? No, it just says registered or not. Then you go ahead and do another Whois query or something to figure out who did.
Yeah, currently by default it doesn't give, but we have to just use some other tool again to make.
Because in registering a domain, the domain registrar has no requirement that you need to provide authenticator.
So then the list is not necessarily all live hosts?
Yes, they are registered domains. They are not live on the internet. This is their registered domains.
Yeah.
They don't have any Recon basically.
Yeah, but sometimes people wanted to not to show their information as well in Whois, so they kind of use Whois guard or something to protect stuff.
Or like folks in the John Doe's.
Yeah. Yeah.
But during an assessment, we're looking around at color domains on the internet, and one of the domains was registered by Mark Zuckerberg. We know it was not.
Yes.
So if you're asked to do an assessment for company X and they say, you know, go find everything that we have, and they're using privacy, right? So now everything is Google, all their DNS is Google. How are you guys confirming that the site belongs to them? If you say you have a list of 1,000 sites.
For the
that's not reasonable to manually confirm.
Yeah, so can we ask?
You mean to say if they given a domain and like
just I want you to see what my company's
like by name or like a kind of name?
Tell you what I have.
I mean to say I'm thinking like do you give the domain as a input for the attacker or like the tester who is going to test
so
or like the company name?
Company,
company name. Oh, okay. Yeah.
And I'm an enterprise worldwide company.
Gotcha.
I have
Yeah.
Divisions, each division has their own
names. Yeah. So it's not always going to be
xdot.com.
Now it's going to be abc.com.
Once you
figure it out. Yeah.
And then how you tie that together, how you confirm it.
Yeah.
And see that x register each one of those.
Maybe one thing is like we can go back and refer to the site Google or some other things. Once we got, we kind of correlate that information. Like, is there any referral URLs from this site to going back to that? Like, if you use some people like Shopify or something, like they kind of use app.shopify, some different URL to give them shops externally, but the main domain is completely different from them. But if you see any of the referrals, like a store, go to click on the store or something, it will go back to the old domain.
There are multiple.
Yeah, it's kind of.
Yeah. One of the common techniques we also use is to use email addresses instead of domain names.
Oh, yeah.
But then you run into the case where I'm using my personal work email to stand up a site that's awesome.
Yeah. What is that?
So we perform that level of OSINT first to figure out. We look at LinkedIn people and a bunch of other sites to figure out who's the authority people in the company who owns particular domains.
Yeah.
What is the admin team? We look at what is the IT, who are the IT folks. Right? The information may not be complete, right? So obviously there. But from that set, we figure out email addresses that would that we've seen on the internet in terms of Whois data. And then use a reverse search to figure out what other domains are used.
So what I'm trying to get to is how do you automate it at scale?
Okay.
And that doesn't, I'm not hearing how to automate something like that at scale. Because that's everything I do, right?
Yeah.
One of the things is you can register with, you know, AWS, everything, but you're hitting a company DNS and you see that.
Okay.
So I'm like, I have high confidence that, you know, x.com DNS is yours. So anything that hits that, I can confirm it as being yours and I can attack.
Yeah.
When it's not like that.
So if you are internal, it will be makes easier. You just look at passive DNS traffic. Like if you are internal organization member and as an internal organization, you wanted to look or test your organization posture, then you kind of look for passive DNS where it will before going out of the, your network like a gateway. So you can look for all passive DNS traffic and profile them. Maybe it is one of the best way to look, because whatever they have to look, they can go through the same DNS which you have organization. So it will give you complete entries. Coming to the external posture, maybe you have to do some kind of work in terms of different techniques and ways to look at. But yeah, it's a little tougher to automate unless you put the manual steps in place and document it. Then that's
yeah.
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 True. Yeah. Cool. So that is the things. I'll just quickly cover whatever the references we have put, like so that you can go back and look at them. The certificate transparency page, like you can go and look at the more details about what, how the way capture and what are the data information they give away, and the places to look if you wanted to get the certificate transparency logs. And there is a blog post we have written, like as a kind of what you call three different formats, like a three types, like three types now, dark side, bright side.
Only two.
Okay. So there is a blog post we have written about more like detail what are the things, information it discloses and about stuff. The project which we were talking when we are doing scenario one, like the Kali Dog security, this is the one which kind of automatically run your own server for listening all the certificate transparency logs. And the Rapid7 open data set is scans.io. So it not only has the forward DNS data set, it also has a bunch of other data sets which you wanted to look and maybe interested. If you see this project shown as thing, yeah, it won't die. This one, yeah, this one. So the project owner has the data sets, like they kind of give you different ways to download. As I said, it's kind of huge if you wanted to download at internet scale, and people kind of use like some huge servers to parse and process. Feel free to go ahead and download and try those stuff, and that is mostly about us. And if you have any questions, you have cards, put it here. Please feel free to take our card or like tweet to us, like happy to answer. And we will be sending this or tweeting about this workshop, the documentation and VM, mostly tomorrow. By tomorrow. Thank you so much, and have a great day.